Good evening and welcome to the 8 o'clock special debate. Today, a new chapter has been written in India's history regarding Kashmir. Article 370, giving Jammu and Kashmir special status, has been virtually scrapped. All its provisions except for Clause 1 have been abolished by a presidential order that came into effect at once this morning. Also, the state has been bifurcated. It has in fact ceased to exist as a state, but now two union territories. That is now Jammu and Kashmir, which becomes one union territory with an assembly like Delhi and Puducherry. Ladakh becomes a separate union territory with no assembly like Daman and Diu. How exactly did this unfold? It was an operation carried out in utmost secrecy from midnight this morning. Jammu and Kashmir leaders were put under house arrest. Landlines were cut off. The internet was down. Also, passes were issued to curfew-like restrictions. Extra troops lifted in. The National Security Advisor Ajit Doval and Home Secretary are currently in Kashmir. Also, the Kashmir leaders have been moved from house arrest to the government guest house Harinivas. They've now been formally arrested, according to Srinagar officials. Meanwhile, in Delhi, from this morning, hectic political activity began. The Prime Minister first met with the Home Minister, then met with the Cabinet Committee on Security and the entire Cabinet. So, a new chapter in history written by the Prime Minister and Home Minister. The BJP says it is correcting a Nehruvian blunder. Today, the Home Minister called Article 370 the genesis of all terrorism in Jammu and Kashmir, adding that its abolition will end bloodshed. Mr. Shah also said this is not targeted at any religion, but will in fact integrate Kashmir with development. The Congress has called this a constitutional monstrosity, but across party lines, there was support from those opposed to the BJP, including Mayawati and Arvind Kejriwal. The bill was passed this evening with a two-thirds majority. The Prime Minister was in the Rajya Sabha to witness that. He will now address the nation on the 7th of August. Look at the top headlines right now. A new chapter in India's history, Article 370, is virtually scrapped. Kashmir's special status is gone.
मैं ये जो दो संकल्प और विधेयक लेकर आया हूँ, मुझे लगता है कि कश्मीर की समस्या के समाधान का रास्ता यहीं से होकर निकलेगा.
In one day, 72 years of Kashmir policy has been rewritten. Look at that notification, also the downgrading from states to union territory. Well, the opposition protests, but there's a divide. The Congress, Mamata, Stalin and Nitish, an NDA ally, oppose, but Mayawati, Arvind Kejriwal, Jagan and Chandrababu Naidu support. Mehbooba and Omar Abdullah are formally arrested. Omar Abdullah's statement says it's an act of aggression against the people of JNK. Mehbooba says it's a dark day for democracy. Celebrations across parts of India, a shutdown in Kashmir. What will the larger impact be? And from the founder of the Jan Sangh, Dr. Prasad Mukherjee, Shyama Prasad Mukherjee's death in a Srinagar jail, to Prime Minister Modi's mission accomplished for the BJP today. We also have a distinguished panel of guests, but first, let's just track what happened on this historic day in Parliament today. As we said, in Parliament from 11 a.m. to 7 p.m., the whole history of Jammu and Kashmir policy has been rewritten.
Complete mockery.
You will bear responsibility.
Invest money.
माननीय सभापति महोदय, ये
ये सत्य नहीं है। महाराजा हरि सिंह द्वारा 27 अक्टूबर 1947 को इस चुनी जम्मू और कश्मीर साइन किया गया। मैं फिर से किसी कहना चाहता हूँ 27 अक्टूबर 1947 को और धारा 370 1949 में आई जम्मू कश्मीर छूटने के बाद 2 साल तक। गुलाम नबी साहब ने कहा कि धारा 370 ऐतिहासिक है, मैं इसके विवाद में जाना नहीं चाहता, मगर मैं जो बिल लेकर आया हूँ वो भी ऐतिहासिक है, इतिहास बनाने वाला बिल।
शर्म की बात है कि जम्मू कश्मीर को आपने नॉन एंटिटी बना दिया, एक लेफ्टिनेंट गवर्नर बनाकर, ताकि आप चपरासी भी यहीं से बना ले, ताकि आपकी क्लर्क की अपॉइंटमेंट भी यहीं से करे। क्या होता हमने देख रहे हैं, 4 साल से चीफ मिनिस्टर बेचारा पांडिचेरी का रोज आता, एक लेफ्टिनेंट गवर्नर उसको काम करने नहीं देता, हर चीज के लिए सांस लेने के लिए भी लेफ्टिनेंट गवर्नर के पास जाना जाता।
Something which this country has been waiting for the last 70 years. Even as latest as 2019, our manifesto during the Lok Sabha election was elaborately mentioning the need for the abrogation of Article 370. All this is not without consultation. And therefore, to think that we've just popped it out of somewhere, you know, suddenly from the hat like a magic rabbit, not at all.
Momentarily, you think you have scored a victory. The drum beats that you will hear on the streets will certainly encourage you to believe that you have scored a signal victory, or as one of the honorable members said, you have corrected, quote unquote, a so-called injustice of history. You are wrong. And history will prove you to be wrong, and future generations will realize what a grave mistake this house is making today. You will reduce states to colonies. The other thing that you are doing, dismembering Jammu and Kashmir, dismembering Jammu and Kashmir, for heaven's sake, in the name of the people of India, I appeal to you, don't do that.
जम्मू कश्मीर लिया, कहां बलूचिस्तान ले गए, बीओके ले गए, और जो हमारा देश का अखंड हिंदुस्तान का जो सपना है, मुझे विश्वास है ये देश की सरकार, ये देश के प्रधानमंत्री और देश के गृह मंत्री जरूर अखंड हिंदुस्तान का सपना पूरा करेंगे।
टुडे इज अ वेरी ब्लैक डे, इंडियन कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन हैज बीन रेप्ड बाय द बीजेपी गवर्नमेंट।
यू प्लेड विद द सेंटीमेंट्स ऑफ द पीपल ऑफ कश्मीर। Sir, what is bothering me for the last few days when the army was completely, army personnel 2 lakh times were deployed there, really I am, my heart is burning, because it should not become a Kosovo. Kashmir should not become a Kosovo. Kashmir should not become a East Timor. Kashmir should not become a South Sudan. That may happen.
सही अर्थ में जम्मू और कश्मीर भारत का हिस्सा बना, आज बना।
इट्स अ वेरी प्राउड डे बिकॉज इन फ्यूचर वी विल नॉट हैव बिल्स विच विल हैव द क्लॉज विच सेज दिस विल नॉट बी एप्लीकेबल टू द स्टेट ऑफ जम्मू एंड कश्मीर।
दिस इज अ ब्लैक मंडे, दिस इज अ डार्क डे, a dark day for parliamentary democracy, a dark day for federalism, a dark day for constitution, a dark day for the Rajya Sabha, and a dark day for the idea of India.
Article 370 was a miscarriage of history and one of the gravest blunders of the post-independence India. The common man वॉकिंग इन दी स्ट्रीट्स ऑफ श्रीनगर टुडे इज रिजॉइसिंग इट। वो बोल नहीं सकता क्योंकि खौफ का पर्दा उसके ऊपर। आई कंक्लूड बाई सेइंग that we are a part of a global world. India today is a part of a global world. And we have no right absolutely to deprive Jammu and Kashmir being a part of this global world.
We won Kashmir. Today you have lost Kashmir.
Right.
That is the point, sir.
That is your point. Okay.
We won Kashmir. You have lost Kashmir.
Jawaharlal Nehru ji ne bhi kaha tha ki 370 चिंता मत करो घिसते घिसते घिस जाएगी मगर 370 को इतने जतन से संभाल कर रखा 70 साल हुए घिसी नहीं और आप मुझे बताइए ये टेम्पररी प्रोविजन है सब स्वीकार करते हैं टेम्पररी शब्द 70 साल तक चल सकता है क्या कब जाएगा कैसे जाएगा ये 370 के भूत ने वहां अलगाववाद को मानने वाले युवाओं के मन में उनको गुमराह कर एक बड़ी नाराजगी की भावना खड़ी की इसमें कोई उचित समय की जरूरत नहीं थी पॉलिटिकल विल चाहिए थी मत बैंक की राजनीति से ऊपर उठकर देश के लिए फैसला करने का जिगर चाहिए था कोई भी लीगल स्क्रूटिनी से इस बिल को कोई कुछ नहीं होने वाला है हर लीगल ऐसे ही नॉर्मल परिस्थिति हो जाएगी उचित समय आएगा हम इसको फिर से स्टेट बनाने के लिए हमें मैं कहता हूं हमें 5 साल दे दीजिए हम कश्मीर को देश का सबसे ज्यादा विकसित राज्य बनाएं
सो देयर इट इज इन लेस देन 8 आवर्स 72 इयर्स ऑफ कश्मीर पॉलिसी रीरिटन व्हाट आर द इम्प्लिकेशंस व्हाट इज द इम्पैक्ट आई हैव विद मी अ डिस्टिंग्विश्ड पैनल ऑफ गेस्ट आई हैव विद मी अ यंग लद्दाख एमपी मिस्टर चमयांग सेरिंग Namikyal, also joining me from Ladakh, Lok Sabha MP. Also with me, ex-Law Minister Ashwini Kumar. I'm also joined by Wajahat Habibullah. He was the former Commissioner of Kashmir from 1990 to 93, those militancy hit years. Also chairman, ex-chairman of the Minorities Commission. I'm also joined by Desh Ratan Nigam, political analyst, right-wing political analyst. Also with me, Amrendra Sharan, senior lawyer, and Priyanka Chaturvedi of the Shiv Sena. I'll start with you, Mr. Namikyal, because for Ladakh, this is a big day. What are your first reactions? You are from the BJP, so you will support it. But did it come as a huge surprise to you?
Yeah, it's obviously a very welcoming step. And all the people of Ladakh are today very happy for this historic decision. And for last 7 decades, we have been, you know, pursuing this demand. This is a very long-standing demand and very genuine demand. Mm-hmm. Because we are just skipped with the Kashmir without any commonality. Our culture, our geographical, our climate condition, everything is different, but still we kept with Kashmir. Mm-hmm. We don't know why, but today we are getting our dues. Mm-hmm. So that's why people of Ladakh are very happy and we are welcoming this step. Mm-hmm.
Let me bring in ex-Law Minister Ashwini Kumar. Mr. Kumar, we saw there the heated debate and already we've heard voices from within the Congress. We heard Mr. Chidambaram, ex-Home Minister, Ghulam Nabi Azad, former Chief Minister, saying it was a constitutional monstrosity. Ghulam Nabi Azad said this is really making tukre of Jammu and Kashmir. But Congress voices are now coming out against this. Your Chief Whip of the Rajya Sabha resigned today, saying that the Congress is out of touch. We've seen more. Janardhan Dwivedi has just spoken, saying he supports this. Is the Congress on the wrong side of history today?
Well, I'm not prepared to go as far as that, saying that the Congress is on the wrong side of history. But I must confess that on historic moments, on decisions such as this, as critical for the nation's future as this, people are entitled to have their views. And I think there's nothing wrong in it. I, for one, feel that there are only 3 issues with which I have a difficulty. One, I fear that we might alienate the Kashmiri youth forever. Because the decision is not only about bread alone. We don't live
forever
by bread alone.
Forever is a strong word.
Sorry?
Forever is a strong word.
Well, you know, I mean, there are certain decisions that have an irretrievable impact. And this is linked to the cultural identity of the people of Kashmir, to their geographical identity, to the identity linked with their consciousness. Article 370 is a part of the conscience of Kashmir, right or wrong. It was a product of history. Now, of course, one can argue that history is an evolution. All history is contemporary history. People take decisions in order to undo what happened in the past so that you can look ahead into the future. These are all very well. Mm-hmm. But as of now, considering the ground reality in Kashmir, the already festering sense of alienation, this will further alienate people. That's my fear. I hope it does not happen. Mm-hmm. I would be very happy if the optimism of the Home Minister came to be true. Second, the imminent possibility of internationalization of the Kashmir issue. Pakistan's ability to divert attention from terrorism and focus it on Kashmir is a real possibility. And the third, the impact that this might have on the psyche of the minorities in the rest of the country. But having said that, I must, in deference to intellectual integrity, say that there are certain positive consequences that might flow from this decision. Mm-hmm. So history alone will attest to the ultimate wisdom of the decision. Sitting here today, when the thing has just happened in your studio, I cannot claim that I can foresee how things will turn out. But based upon my understanding and reading of history, such decisions have a very long-lasting impact. It could be positive, it could be negative.
That's an important point. So you're not taking a position at this current moment, and that's true. What we know is that history has been rewritten. What the impact of it is now, well, future generations may well judge even what happens in the next few hours. But let me ask somebody, Mr. Wajahat Habibullah, who knows Kashmir very well, who was sent in the 90s at that time when also the militancy hit years. Mr. Habibullah, there is a view, and perhaps the BJP has articulated that best, that we've seen what's happened with Kashmir in the last 72 years. As the Home Minister said, we've lost 41,000 lives. If the current policy isn't working, what's wrong with trying a paradigm shift? As this young MP just pointed out as well, why not rewrite our whole equation with how we've dealt with this?
Sonia, I'm glad that you asked this question. If the issue is that how will this this help, that this division of the state into two union territories and the withdrawal of Article 370, how is this going to help resolve the present crisis through which the state is going through? Because there's no doubt about it, it's going through a crisis. Mm-hmm. Where is that crisis? That crisis is in Kashmir. In the state of Jammu and Kashmir, you had Ladakh, who was a peaceful area. Most of Jammu has remained placid. There was a crisis inside Kashmir. And unfortunately, reaction inside Kashmir speaks for itself. The fact that the entire political leadership had to be actually arrested, including what we call the mainstream political leadership, had to be placed under detention. There are curfew conditions. There's widespread deployment of security services, security forces inside the valley. As you know, they've recently increased the number of security forces there. So if the problem was inside Kashmir, mm-hmm. What I have been writing about and what my attempt has always been, mm-hmm. to try and reach out to the Kashmiris to make them feel more part of India, make them feel Indians, which I believe that they are. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, that has received a setback by this measure. Not that I believe that Article 370 was the ideal, mm-hmm. safeguard of their feeling of freedom. The point is that I'm quite aware of the fact that Article 370 has a lot of shortcomings, and I had also worked in extending a number of Indian laws, including the RTI Act, to J&K, yes. which now will not be necessary. But it was necessary to have consultation with the people who you hope to benefit as a consequence of your legislation.
So you're saying
that in this case was not done, mm-hmm. and therefore, possibly because of misunderstanding, there is widespread resentment inside the valley for this amendment.
I'm going to bring it because you're making case. So you're actually questioning perhaps more the manner in which it was done, the lack of consultation, than perhaps the actual deed or the actual, well, virtual abrogation, because the penalty clause 1 of Article 370 still exists. I just want to bring in Priyanka Chaturvedi there. Priyanka Chaturvedi of the Shiv Sena, and the Shiv Sena was amongst the first to welcome this decision. We saw Uddhav Thackeray giving laddus, distributing laddus at the press conference there. Aditya Thackeray saying these are the reasons why we joined the NDA. And also in Parliament, we had your MP Sanjay Raut, Priyanka Chaturvedi, saying that now we're going to go after POK. So some would say, okay, this is now going a bit on the extreme at this point, but do you think logically that this is a decision which the time had come, the fact that it's been passed by a two-thirds majority is also an indicator that politically this has widespread support?
Absolutely. Article 370 and abrogation of Article 370 was something that the Shiv Sena was very committed to. And right from Balasaheb Thackerayji's days, where he's committed to the people of Kashmir, that there cannot be two states within a state where there is a separate rule of law for Kashmiri Pandits being purged out of their own homelands and not getting a chance to return back. And that was also unconstitutional and allowing terrorism to reign supreme. So this was a commitment, and up being a part of NDA was also a part of an article of faith in ensuring that Article 370 would go. I'm very surprised. While NC and PDP have taken a stance which they were bound to take, considering they stand by their own ideas of how Kashmir should be governed, but I'm surprised that Congress has stood against abrogation of Article 370, because when Sri Jawaharlal Nehru brought in Article 370, he categorically mentioned that it was a temporary measure to ensure that the merger of Jammu and Kashmir with the rest of India was peaceful and the transition was peaceful, and it would go as time would, you know, as Jammu and Kashmir would merge in with India. Unfortunately, it became a political tool for many political parties to continue to use instilling fear in the minds of the people.
But
of
Priyanka
Jammu
Chaturvedi,
and
can you support the fact that currently two ex-Jammu and Kashmir chief ministers, Omar Abdullah and Mehbooba Mufti, are currently detained in a government guest house? The fact, and this they both pointed out, that we have actually supported Indian democracy, we've been part of it, Omar Abdullah and Mr. Vajpayee's government, Mehbooba Mufti in alliance with the BJP just last year. Can you, as a political observer, as an active politician, support them being detained like this?
No, I just like to mention one thing. Supporting democracy while maintaining the status quo of Article 370 in Jammu and Kashmir is not supporting democracy in totality and ensuring integration of Jammu and Kashmir in totality with the rest of the country. I was listening to the Congress spokesperson say that it is going to disconnect the youth of Jammu and Kashmir forever. I beg to differ, and beg to differ very strongly, because youth of Kashmir was looking for development. Youth of Kashmir wants jobs. Youth of Kashmir wants to feel integrated with the rest of the country. You cannot have a nation which is progressing and one part of the country not progressing because Article 370 holds it back. So removing that has been actually justifying why Jammu and Kashmir needs to integrate with the rest of the country. You cannot have terrorism perpetrate there. You cannot have Pakistan continue to interfere and deprive people of Jammu and Kashmir, because there are few stakeholders who continue to believe that 370 is the be-all and end-all of Kashmir's existence. That is unfortunate.
Well, let me just go across to Amrinder Sharan for a legal viewpoint, because actually let's just look at the legal bedrock on which these two, as I said, these are two dramatic announcements came in Parliament today. Mr. Sharan, if you're with me, just to ask on two points. One is, interestingly, that Clause 3 of Article 370 was actually used by the Home Minister today to say that this has given me the power to actually declare this null and void. The presidential order was based on Clause 3 of Article 370. Do you agree with that? Secondly, and this is a more controversial point perhaps, which the Trinamool Congress, Derek O'Brien, has raised, downgrading in a sense Kashmir, Jammu and Kashmir, to two union territories. Now, the logic being used again by the Home Minister was that since currently there is governor's rule, president's rule in Jammu and Kashmir, the powers of the state assembly now rest with the Indian Parliament. So if Parliament passes a bill making Jammu and Kashmir a true union territories, that is the consent of the state assembly. Again, Derek O'Brien raising, well, what if you do that in West Bengal tomorrow? What if you do it in Orissa tomorrow? Impose president's rule, then have it passed by Parliament, where you have a majority now virtually in both houses. Do you think there are worrying implications there?
I think there are very serious constitutional and legal implications in this issue. Firstly, Article 373, sub Article 3, mm-hmm. clearly mentions that no presidential order can be passed without consulting the Constituent Assembly. Recently, in a judgment, Supreme Court had an occasion to interpret it, where Justice Nariman had said that this is a mandatory provision, and without consulting the Constituent Assembly, no presidential order can be passed. This happened in 2017 in the SBI versus Santosh Kumar. Justice Nariman has categorically stated this, that 370 can be abrogated or amended only by a presidential order, and that presidential order can only be passed after consulting the Constituent Assembly. If there is no Constituent Assembly, then Constituent Assembly had to be constituted for this purpose. The substitution of the Constituent Assembly by Governor is an issue which will be very difficult to sustain in a court of law, because Assembly and Governor are completely different bodies, and this amendment of Article 370 on the basis of Article 367 is also erroneous, because I believe that Article 370 starts with a non-stante clause that notwithstanding anything contained in this Constitution. That means no part of the Constitution will have an overriding effect on 370. 370 that way is a standalone clause, and all its requirements ought to have been met.
So this will now go to the Supreme Court. Already heard
therefore
that, but
coming that it's a
come. I'm just going to get Mr. Nigam in on that. Those points raised.
Or Jammu and Kashmir High Court.
Somebody yes. who Mr. Sharan's explanation or the argument picks up 370 in between. It does not go to the source. The source is interim, transitional, and temporary. And what was meant 370 was for the interim period, not the permanent government which came into being. So therefore, the permission of the Constituent Assembly was only confined to that interim period. Mm-hmm. After that, the role
the
of Constituent
nature.
Yes, after that, the role of the Constituent Assembly ended. So then the permanent government took over. So it cannot be beyond. Either the permission you see of the state government is the interim state government. So the permanency which has been given is fallacious, illegal. It was a temporary, transitional, and interim provision only for that transition from interim government to the permanent government. So picking up, cherry picking in between does not give the constitutional status of a permanent status to 370.
Does the ex-law minister agree with that? Do you think there are implications for other states?
Well, there would be implications for other states. There could be implications for other states. But I just want to make a point on Article 370, although I don't want to reduce this debate to legalities, that mm-hmm. the court will look into it. But I do want to make a point. You know, somebody said, constitutions do not contain rules for the passing hour. They contain principles for an expanding future. So 370 is something that is sacrosanct in terms of the cultural identity, the geographical realities and the historical processes that went into 370. So I wanted to answer and then quickly go because I have to go somewhere else. I wanted to answer the Shiv Sena spokesperson. She talked about jobs, she talks about material prosperity. All of that is very good and that must be available to everyone. I agree with that. But I repeat, I stated in my opening that nations and civilizations are not defined by bread alone. They are defined by culture, they are defined by history, they are defined by geography, and they are defined by hope. You cannot take away the identity of people. You can't take away the emotions of the people and then look at a problem only in terms of bread and butter. That
right.
is not how
well,
we
I'm
have lived.
I'm going to come back to that debate, but we have a very special guest joining us now, the former Chief of Army Staff, General Deepak Kapoor. And General Kapoor, let me go across to you, because of course the security forces have played such a crucial role in Jammu and Kashmir. Today also we know additional paramilitary troops have been moved in, the army on high alert as well on the borders. What are your reactions, sir, to the dramatic rewriting of history that has happened today?
Sonia, I'd like to begin by saying that the abrogation of Article 370 was long overdue. Mm-hmm. It has been divisive in nature, and it was hampering the integration of the state of Jammu and Kashmir with the rest of the country. And not only that, it therefore encouraged outsiders, external forces, to get on with the proxy war by concentrating on the division within the Indian Union, because the local parties had their own agenda and they wished to continue with it and sufficient support to their angst was provided by the neighbors in terms of military support, moral support, financial support to continue with this proxy war. So the kind of terrorism and proxy war which has been going on is partially attributable to the Article 370, which has been in existence. And I wish it had happened earlier, but now that it has happened, I think it strikes at the root cause of terrorism and insurgency in the valley, like Mr. Amit Shah said. But while it doesn't remove insurgency, that is something which the security forces would have to continue to fight for. But if the root cause is taken care of, it would perhaps be only a matter of time that the insurgency and terrorism in the valley will wither away. To that extent, it was long overdue.
General Kapoor, thank you very much for your very forthright statements there, saying that this will actually help in ending terrorism in the valley. That's what the Home Minister said. Let me go across to now another exclusive guest joining us tonight, Mr. Harish Salve. Mr. Harish Salve, of course, the former Solicitor General of India, most recently also put up that outstanding case for Mr. Kulbhushan Jadhav, who's currently on the death row in Pakistan. Mr. Salve, your response on the constitutional perspective of what's happened today. What do you think the implications actually are? Two aspects being raised, one on whether Article 370 can be abrogated in this manner, and two, the larger implications of the Parliament taking over the State Assembly's role to declare a state a union territory.
Let's take them separately, yes, because I am little surprised at the suggestion that Article 370 has been abrogated. Mm-hmm. I've seen the bill. There's only one bill for a constitution, for a legal amendment, and that is the reorganizational bill. As far as Article 370 is concerned, 371D, if I remember correctly, provides for applying such provisions of the constitution as the president may from time to time notify by order, and with such exceptions and such modifications as may be necessary. In 1954, when the presidential order was issued, 50 it was issued, 52 it was issued, 54 there was a presidential order which extended part 3, i.e. the fundamental rights to Kashmir. It extended the jurisdiction of the Supreme Court to Kashmir. At that time, 35A was inserted for what we call reverse discrimination, i.e. it prevented anybody from outside Kashmir from asserting the right of Article 19(1)(c) and 14 to go and freely settle in Kashmir. That presidential order has been superseded by a new presidential order, which very simply says the whole of the Indian constitution will now apply. So Article 370 itself has been used to apply the whole of the Indian constitution to Kashmir. That is my understanding. Mm-hmm. So I don't know why there is this talk about 370 being abrogated. An amendment of a constitutional provision would require Parliament two-third present and voting. That has not taken place, and it is not necessary. So that's as far as 35A and the special status
important distinction there, yes.
Yes. And the 370 itself contemplated, and 370, which is marked temporary provisions, itself contemplated that provisions of the constitution can be extended. Mm-hmm. Part 3, which is the most, one of the most significant parts of our constitution, i.e. the fundamental rights, were extended in 54 with an exception. The exception has been done away, so the fundamental rights in their plenitude apply. Mm-hmm. Now, if there is a local law which gives preference to tribals or other things, that may generally be protected still. But the overarching notion of residents of Jammu and Kashmir alone being allowed to buy in Jammu and Kashmir goes away.
So basically the special status...
That's as far as 35
basically the special
is
status being given has gone. It is now at par with any other state of India, is what you would
to
say.
To the residents of that
yes.
state. That's right. That's yeah, that is what has been done. Mm-hmm. Secondly, the other change is reorganization of states, the way Chhattisgarh was created, mm-hmm. the way Jharkhand was created. It's a two-tier process. Article 2 and 3 now become applicable with this presidential order. Mm-hmm. Now, 2 and 3 allow reorganization of states, well-settled law. Even when Andhra was created, that's the power they used, you know, when they carved out Telangana from Andhra. So, this requires two steps.